Subscribe to Film Companion for your film fix. Hit the bell icon so you never miss an update. Hey guys, welcome to Film Companion. Welcome to Spill the Tea. On the show today, I'm taking a food trail in South Mumbai and I'm joined by self-proclaimed foodie and funny man, Rohan Joshi.
Hi, how's it going?
Welcome to Spill the Tea.
Thank you. It's lovely to be here.
It's safe to say that this is the most my team has ever traveled for a shoot. Because
really?
You insisted on doing this in the south of Bombay.
I did.
Where
I did.
You grew
this
up.
This is where I grew up. So I was born and raised. I will make you travel to this end of town.
We have. But what is on the agenda? What is around us?
So around us is chaat, is pav bhaji, is kulfi, is chocolate milk, is basically everything that your mom wouldn't let you eat at home as a kid. So you fled here and you ate it, basically.
I watched an interview where you said that being born in South Bombay, you're born with a certain natural arrogance.
Yes, it's true.
For someone who's not from South Bombay or not from Bombay even,
right.
What is the difference between this sobo towny kid and the rest of us?
In several words, a crap load of privilege. That is the single biggest difference, I think, between townies and this thing. What happens if you're born here, the perception is you were born with a silver spoon in your mouth. That is not always incorrect. The perception is that you were born in a place where you didn't really have to care too much about what was going on in the outside world or how people who were less economically or socially or this thing advantages you had to live. And the perception is that basically you don't know anything about the outside world. The joke is that the world ends in a 5 kilometer radius of where you live and everything else is outer space, basically.
Correct.
So every city, I know whoever's watching, whatever city, your city has one of those. Has an enclave
admit it, somewhere.
There's people in Delhi who are nodding, there's people in Indore who are nodding, there's people in every city who are nodding right now. Basically, just think about that person in your city who comes from that place that you hate.
You. Let's go sit over there and get us some food. I'm going to let you order.
Okay, what is the vibe? Is the vibe chaat or is the vibe pav bhaji or is the vibe like kulfi? What is the scene?
What's good here since you're showing me around?
So chaat is always good. Chaat is always a winner. You can't go wrong. Also with like one solid pav bhaji, you can't go wrong. So how about, tell you this, we'll do one pav bhaji.
Okay.
And you pick a chaat.
I'll pick a chaat.
There we go. Let's outsource the decision-making process.
So someone comes up to you, I'm assuming,
I think so.
Right?
I think so. Yes, they're all there. So, we'll just... Sir, ek pav bhaji, please.
Aur ek ragda patty.
Medium?
What does that mean?
You matlab tikha medium ya?
Tikha medium.
Achha, toh fir medium. Toh fir medium, haan. Agar tikha medium.
Jaldi. Thank you.
Which is the other thing I've learned about street food places is, never say tikha. Because by normal standards, what he said is right. Medium is tikha. And if you say tikha, somewhere in their ego, they go, achha.
Achha. Achha. Achha.
Achha. Achha. Tu tikha khayega. And then horrible things happen, inevitably.
You're the first person I've interviewed who's agreed to just come out and do like a gorilla style shoot.
Okay.
I don't know whether we're going to complete this. We hope.
I think
that
we will.
Do.
I think also, like, I may be like one of the least famous people that you have got out here. Like,
that's
I can't
debatable.
Imagine like a movie star.
Ooh, that's
being
quick.
Allowed to.
Thank you,
sir.
Ooh.
That looks pretty good. Yeah, that was quick actually.
Did we say tikha?
That was quick to the degree where I'm a little suspicious.
Yeah.
Like, was that already there? Ready, waiting. I just
YouTube
want to point
comments
out,
are
guys,
gonna be like, oh, they're cheating this
no,
shit.
What YouTube comments are really going to be is lol, kanda nahi hai isme. Kyunki kande ka lekin bahut kam hai. Like tomato and cucumber is like making up the bulk of.
Okay, I'm gonna
please
go for
it. But yeah, I figured when you called we should do something that's
we did
like,
not pre-order this stuff.
No, we did. That's the best part.
Thank
none
you.
Of this is cheated. It's just there. It's just the chopati life.
Do you remember your first ever gig?
Oh yeah, absolutely remember. I went up there and I was extremely nervous. I still remember. I was wearing green and white shorts and I was
big
wearing a purple
day, huh?
T-shirt.
Huh? Big day in your life.
Big day in my life. I didn't know it then though. I didn't know the big day in my life then. I just thought this thing, I was trying for fun. I was a journalist at the time.
Yeah.
And I thought that would be my job forever. And I made this joke, and I still remember the very stupid introductory joke. All I said is, hi, my name is Nervous and I'm very, very Rohan.
I'm still laughing.
Exactly. I know. And that's what I counted on. And 200 people burst out laughing at that. And that first laugh that I got, I was like, oh crap, this is it. This is the job now. This is life now. Like nothing else is going.
They're still celebrating.
See, it's a joke sign. You see that? You can hear that. That was in response to the joke. It just took 5 seconds for it to travel there. But response to the joke. And I really enjoyed myself on stage. And that was it. I remember coming off feeling like a high, like an active high. And I was like, holy crap, this is great. At least for fun, I plan to do this very regularly.
But how long did it take you to make it a respectable
career? I would say about a year and a half. Okay. A year and a half.
Because opportunity. Is it easier now?
It's yes and no. In the sense that there are probably infinitely more opportunities available to comics in terms of whether it's stage time, whether it's freelance writing gigs, whether it's all of that. No, in the sense that back then there were 10 of us. Now there are 10,000 people aspiring to be comics. So the actual glut of comedians.
Thanks to you guys.
Thanks is a big word. thanks is a very big word. But yeah, I think a lot of us were very lucky to be in the right place at the right time. And yeah, I mean, we worked hard to build the scene. I think there was a group of about 10 to 20 comics in the early days who were saying yes to gigs in the worst of places, under the worst of conditions, just so we could open up new stages. People traveling with next to no logistical support to get it done, which is very different from now, where if you're, say, a represented artist, things are taken care of. You know certain venues will be...
I got you through your manager.
You got me through... I don't know why, though. I have no idea why. That seemed like the most roundabout way for you to get to me. As sweet as my manager is, she's sitting right there. I'm not looking. Yeah, in a sense, it's definitely easier now, in a sense, because there's 10 years of a comedy scene in India. It's probably easier for somebody to look at their family and be like, hey, I aspire to try this. But it's also probably harder because I've seen it now, right? Like, if I go to 8 open, there was a time where if I went to an open mic or a show, I could tell you the name of every single person there. Now I could attend 5 separate open mics and I won't know a single comic on them. That's a good thing. That's a good sign because it means that the scene is so big that it's not possible for you to know every
single artist. But does it make you nervous? Like, is it?
Oh, of course it makes me nervous. I think in any art form, if you do it right, you essentially become the pathway to your own irrelevance.
Heavy.
It's heavy, but it's true, I think, right? I think if you open up an art form and you do it, I think the idea is 10 years from now, there should be somebody with a different, fresher voice. If you're still the person at top of the game, it's bad for the scene itself. So in that sense, yeah, because there was a time where it was just us and you look back and there was nobody. And now you look back and it's not even like those guys are there. They're like here, right? And they constantly push you to write better. They constantly push you to want to perform better, because what happens with most audiences now, especially in a city like Bombay, which has so much comedy, like you can get comedy 7 nights a week in Bombay now.
Yeah.
Your average audience member is like, yeah, I'm not laughing at that Guju Panju joke I was laughing
anymore.
At 7 years ago, you know, give me something better.
Yeah.
And then you have to stand on stage and be like, oh, I guess I'm gonna have to do some work now.
The last time we bumped into each other, funnily enough, was also at a restaurant.
Yes. Yes.
And you were just grabbing a bite before you ran off to what you said was this really tiny hole in the wall kind of gig that you were performing.
I would believe that, yes.
I'm very curious to know what these scenes are.
So,
good?
Yeah, very good. Not tikha though.
Not tikha.
Just a little salty. That's right. Expert pav bhaji critiquing here on this show.
Good.
So, these hole in the wall gigs are. Stand up in that sense is a beautiful medium because it's the, if you've noticed, it's leapfrogged some art forms that were around before it also, just in terms of popularity and in terms of just a number of people that sort of patronize it on a day-to-day basis. And one of the reasons that is because it's a very low-cost medium to produce. All you realistically need for a stand-up show is like a 5x5 space for someone to stand, a little light on that person's face, and a microphone. I don't think any other art form has such low
production.
And
a really funny guy.
Well, I mean, debatable. debatable. I've been to shows where that has not always been the case. And I speak for myself here as well. And as a result of that, a lot of places, you see worldwide, it's performed in a lot of really nice, tiny, intimate rooms. As opposed to, before you get to your auditorium where you're playing before 700, 800 people, a lot of comics, even today, some of the biggest comics in the world, when they're trying the material out, are trying it for 30 and 20 and 30 and 20 people.
So, but Rohan, all of this was a new experience for you because this came after the whole, the Me Too jolt of October 2018.
Right.
But it's really hard for anyone not to accept just the grace with which you picked up the pieces, accepted the situation and put yourself out there again.
Okay.
How hard was that for you as an artist?
It was a little difficult, but also at the same time, I like to point out that it was not difficult for me to be graceful in that situation, because also important to remember that I was not the victim.
Correct.
I think it's very obvious that I was not the biggest victim in that, anywhere near the biggest victim in that.
Yeah.
So in that sense, it was a little easier for me than for a lot of people in there.
But things were
to get my head in it. But things were, yeah, it was also difficult just in the sense that I think it's difficult when anything that you built over 8 or 9 years just suddenly collapses. That's difficult. Also, because of the job that we do and because of what we do, I think one trap that I'd fallen into is my entire self-worth was based on what people online thought of me at that time, because I spent so much time on social media, so much time putting myself out there, so much of my image was built on that, that I realized that I had built my image of myself on the basis of what those people think. And to be fair, I get a lot of love from people, I get all of that, but I think on some level you also have to recognize that audiences can also be fickle, or in the sense that people are emotional, so they can, if they see something that makes you sort of makes them not like you, they will flip in an instant. So that love that was coming to you with a certain degree, the anger will also come with that same ferocity and that same degree and that same this thing, and when that happens, it's a little difficult to absorb.
Yeah, I can imagine.
All at once, because then you start to wonder, am I a terrible person, am I the worst of the worst? And of course some of that introspection is very warranted, because you want to come out changed, you want to come out in a way where if you participated, even if you weren't directly involved, if you participated in a workplace culture that did not, that where people did not feel 100% comfortable, you want to make sure that when you do it next, you do it right. You want to make sure that all your interactions going forward are better. So there was, I feel like, this intense 3 month, 4 month period where I really went into a shell, where I kind of essentially rebuilt myself brick by brick almost. There was this period in November, December where I didn't know when and where my next paycheck was coming from. Which is also kind of interesting in a sort of just having to go back to basics and chip away at work from scratch almost, which was a great challenge.
What did it teach you new about yourself almost a decade later from when you started?
One, I'm a little more resilient than I give myself credit for. Two, I am a little more emotional than I should be. And three, I guess I just need to listen better to certain people and about certain things, and keep that in mind while rebuilding myself. I think those were three things that were hugely important to me.
Did it really just help you reevaluate friendships in the age of social media?
It helped me reevaluate a bunch of different relationships, not just friendships. I think it helped me reevaluate a lot of friendships, a lot of familial bonds, a lot of also just the difference between people who are your friends and people you just happen to be connected to tenuously through this membrane of social media. Because it's very easy to think certain people are your friends because you communicate over shared experiences online or whatever. But sometimes they then, in moments of crisis, say things that make you realize that, well, I mean, I wish you'd read past the headline, if that makes any sense. And then there's other people who you also realize will, in situations of crisis for you, be tough but fair at the same time. That there are people who are capable of being saying, well, you fucked up, but also pick yourself back up. And I think those are the friends that you value and you learn to value the most in that time. And yeah, there was a huge realigning of relationships and priorities. I realized in those 2 months that I had no work how much I'd just let a bunch of family and friendships suffer over the last 7 years, because I'd focused so much 24/7 on work and things
like
that.
Has that changed? Are you less on the internet now?
Massively. I'm less on the internet. And even if I am as much on the internet, I'm a little less on the narcissistic parts of the internet than I used to be. I realized I was spending so much time just on social media. And when you're on social media, essentially it's about you. Here's my thoughts. Here's my photograph. Here's what I ate. Here's what I did. Here's what I think. Here's what this thing. And then I went, my whole life over the last 7 years has just been thrusting me and my opinions upon people. And I said,
and with your following, it's a lot of people.
It's a lot of people, right? And it can be very heady,
yeah,
right?
Of course.
To keep giving opinions out and have people go, bravo. And you're like, well, maybe I should give one more opinion. And it can get kind of heady. But then I realized that I was spending so much time on that, I was spending no time learning new things. I was just giving my opinion on things that I already knew or already thought I knew, and I wasn't learning anything new. So over the last year, I've spent way more time on the parts of the internet that teach you things. I've spent way more time on things like just online tutorial videos and
what
just reading history. Well, I'm learning the drums.
You're learning the drums?
One, I am. I'm learning the drums. I take classes. I also look at online tutorial videos.
Nice.
I'm trying, made very basic beginnings towards teaching myself Spanish on Duolingo. It's not going so well so far. It's been about like a week or
You're
two.
You're working out
I'm
a
working
lot?
I'm working out a lot. I decided my health was a thing that I needed to fix. Because I mean, I'm 36 years old and I realized that every year I put it off, it's just going to get harder and harder and harder. And I think with the lives we live, I'm pretty sure I'm at the halfway mark of my life. Like,
wow,
in terms of given, is it though 36 into 72?
Okay.
I think I'd do well to make it to 72,
okay.
Given my lifestyle.
Let me tell you how it looks on the outside.
Okay.
It's a bunch
okay.
of friends
yes.
who travel the world,
yes.
tell jokes, you're your own bosses. What is the biggest myth about being a comedian that you want to bust? Yeah, aisa hi hai. Matlab life set hai.
No, that is one myth I would definitely like to bust after this bite of pav bhaji. Unlike a lot of jobs, we have two components to ours. There's a side of it that faces the camera and faces the world. And there's the other component of it, which is all the backroom stuff that nobody will see. So, do we have a ton of fun? Do we get up on stage with our friends and make people laugh and do all of that? 100%. But that is just the best hour of my job. There were a full 9 hours leading up to it where I was up till 2 o'clock in the morning trying to write this joke.
Jokes keep you up at night.
Jokes keep you up at night. If you're writing an AIB video and you're on deadline, like say for example, you want to do a video about Diwali.
Right.
You can't be like, well, it'll be ready in 7 weeks. Diwali's in 2 weeks. End of story, right? And if I want a good quality video, it means sometimes writing 3 drafts, throwing them out, writing 4 drafts, throwing them out. So what you're not seeing on camera is that time that I came to office at 11 a.m. on Monday and didn't leave until 3 a.m. on Wednesday because idea nahi baith raha tha. What you don't see is that in a particular week to get from, where was it that week? From Delhi to Chandigarh and then all the way down to Manipal.
What?
Will involve over 3 consecutive nights. Will involve 2 nights continuously just not sleeping because that's the only way you can make the travel to get there. What they won't see is that after you get off that stage, you're not going off and partying. You're just looking for the nearest bed you can find so you can just collapse in exhaustion. And I don't deny lots of fun aspects to our job. But the biggest myth I'd like to bust is we work the same length of workday as pretty much anybody else. We just have the flexibility to choose what those workdays can be. We have the flexibility to choose starting those workdays as noon as opposed to at 9 a.m.
How do you cope with writer's block?
I'll give you the legally correct option of this, which is sometimes I sleep on it. One thing that's genuinely helped, and this is advice that actually I got from a Stephen King book. It's like, if you have the time, then just whatever you're working on, just throw it in one corner and go do something completely ulta. Like, just shut your brain off from it entirely. There will be a point 24, 48 hours later where somewhere in the back of your brain an automatic subroutine will kick in and 5 ideas will come out about it. Or even if they don't, when you go look at it after 72 hours, you will just have such a different perspective on this document that you were so close to emotionally 72
even
hours
if
ago.
Diwali is in thought, 2 weeks.
If Diwali is in 2 weeks, you don't have a choice.
Okay.
Which is why the easiest way to get over writer's block is write in a group.
Okay.
I can't recommend this enough in terms of especially writing like fictional or online content, because when you write in a group, 2 things happen. One, every idea that you put out is challenged. 2, if you're not speaking, somebody else is, and even if you're not contributing an idea, you may challenge an idea that they have, which may then lead to a 3rd idea that is exponentially better.
Nice. Should we go get some dessert?
I think we should 100% go get
Let's
some dessert.
Let's finish this.
Chocolate milkshake, anyone? We have strawberries and cream.
First
and we have a cat.
Season, and we have a cat.
Life is good.
They just follow you around.
They do. They just know. Hello. It's my t-shirt, isn't it? It's my t-shirt that gave it away. Oh, come here. Holy, come here. Is it good? Yes, of course.
Thanks.
Of course. Bachelor strawberry and cream, man.
Let's not talk. This interview is over.
It's done, right?
It's done. You
can
play
my
with
favorite
the cat.
Plan. Now my secret plan. Tired of answering questions.
So good.
Just here, eat this. I have a cat to play with. Cato, come here.
Since I'm not done.
Yes, please ask.
What is the homework of a comedian? Considering your shows are literally mined from
anything and everything that's happening in the world around, from music, from sport, from politics to Bollywood. How are you constantly abreast with what's happening?
I think, like you said, it's the homework of a comic is keep the eyes and ears open at all times. Like at all times. And when I say at all times, I mean as simple as from while reading the newspaper, obviously.
How many newspapers are you reading?
That's the thing. I'm reading exactly two newspapers. I got so tired of the online news circus and the constant media barrage of everything. I have managed to whittle my total news consumption down to exactly two newspapers. I watch no news channels. I read no online news. I consume two newspapers, the Indian Express and the Mumbai Mirror. I do the Mumbai Mirror because it has phenomenal city and local news. And I do the Indian Express because I have great perspective on international and national news. And one of the biggest learnings of this year has been there is great relief and joy in processing news on a 24-hour delay cycle and a finite amount of news. You cut out a lot of the noise, you cut out a lot of the knee-jerk reactions.
But don't you miss the trends then?
I'm completely 100% okay with that. I am 100% okay to miss the daily trends and focus on what the longer social or political trends are. So your daily trends will keep changing. Like, also you can't predict daily trends. Like, today we'll all be talking about politics, then somewhere on the internet one cat will do something and khatam. Then that's it for the day. Is this what you were expecting when you said you had chocolate milkshake at Bachelor's?
No.
With like little chocolate sprinkles on
those
top.
Those are not little, those are chunks
exactly.
of chocolate.
Exactly. Actual chunks of chocolate. Here. These are actual chocolate chunks. Is this what you were expecting when I said that there would be a chocolate milkshake? The secret history of this chocolate milkshake is this is the answer to the question that every degenerate South Bombay person in their 20s has asked. The question is, bro, I have the munchies, what should we do? And the answer to that question at 2 a.m.
is Bachelor's chocolate milkshake.
Chocolate milkshake while sitting on your car, wondering how you're going to get home, this chocolate milkshake.
I believe it.
This
100%.
Chocolate milkshake. Please try. Isn't it good?
Damn
it's like
good.
Decadent chocolate milkshake, right?
It's been a good day.
That's another thing about Bachelor's. That's a real pleasant surprise. I don't know when it happened.
It's amazing. I wish everyone watching could try this.
They upped their game. So if you order like a simple cheese and chutney sandwich here now, it comes toasted with three sauces and a packet of crisps on the side. Which means you take these street venues, right? And they've also learned to push the game.
Yeah, so what's our excuse?
Exactly, right? So
you know, I was doing a Google search to research for our interview.
Right.
And one of the top trends or the most searched question is Rohan Joshi married?
Rohan Joshi is not married. I'm married to my cats. I'm very married to my cats.
But do you enjoy this female attention?
I mean, I don't have a problem with attention. If I had a problem with attention, I wouldn't be a comedian. But at the same time, while I don't have a problem with the attention, I also have to remember that at the end of the day, it comes from a very good and sweet place. But I can't let it get into my head on a day-to-day basis and sort of be like, oh, look at all this attention I'm getting, how amazing I am, etc., whatever. Because while it is sweet, I'm also aware of the fact that 5 years ago, that affection was going to someone else. 5 years from now, it's going to be going to someone else. And I don't mean that in a way to sort of in any way disparage the affection that people shower on you. It's just that you have to, on some level in the back of your head, be aware that this is transient. It's not going to last forever. And you can't make your moves in life based on that attention. You still got to at the end of the day. Because I'm very aware that it's not an if, it's a when as to when it'll be gone. That's just the nature of what we do. So if I make that...
This awareness was always there.
Took a while. When you get the rug pulled out from under you a couple of times, you sort of learn the transience.
But it's also interesting to mention here that you, despite all the attention, have been ghosted a couple of times online.
Yeah, I've been ghosted. I think, but those are the
things
of modern dating.
But what does this do for your natural South Bombay arrogance?
Nothing. Yeah, I think dating mein koi arrogance nahi hota.
Nahi hota.
I think dating mein there's a point at which that saying, some days you're the pigeon and some days you're the statue. I think dating is the single greatest leveler in that sense. Like, you can think you're amazing, but all it takes is one shit day to show you how painfully mediocre you are in some respects. Been ghosted, not proud of it, dating is
just a level.
It's just like, you know how they say dying is easy, comedy is hard? Comedy is easy. Dating, on the other hand, just no thanks.
What's the most fun thing you've used your fame for? Like, what are the perks you get?
What are the perks of my most fun thing I've used my fame for? That's I think the most single most fun thing. I am a hardcore Avengers fan. And when the director of Avengers, Joe Russo, was coming to town, the first time I flexed a bit and I called my friends at Disney and I'm like, hey, you think I can get 5 minutes in a room?
Oh, you did that?
I did, and I met him and I sat there for 5 minutes just chatting with the guy who directed Avengers Endgame. And I walked out of there thinking, I could not have imagined in my lifetime that this is a thing that I'd get to do. And then the next day I was on a video call with Robert Downey Jr.
Whoa.
And I was like, I did not imagine in my lifetime that this is a thing that I would get to do. Once in a while, people will send over a bottle of alcohol, which is great because in that sense, that college-ness never leaves, you know.
Of course not.
Paying for daru hurts. Right? It doesn't matter. Like, my theory is that whether you're Mukesh Ambani or whether you're whatever, when someone tells you the price of a bottle of daru, you're a bit like, free mein milti to achha hota.
Ab mil raha hai
life mein, toh khatam. And once in a way, people will send like free food and shit, and that's enough. Like, I'm a very simple person. I'm very easily, my soul is very easily sold and bought. It's like some people need Lambos and Ferraris. You feed me well, and I'm done.
You have a show coming out, which you don't have a date to.
January at some point, hopefully.
What can you tell us about it?
What I can tell you about it is that it's my first solo stand-up special. It's just largely my thoughts on being in my 30s. Because when I started doing this, I was in my 20s. And I look back on this decade and I realize I was such a child. That a lot of it is just me standing on stage going, guys, I'm buda ho gaya. It's called Wake and Bake. For those of you who know what that means.
Yeah.
Those of you who don't, Google it. It's just a really fun show. It's a collection of jokes. It's not like the preeminent cultural document of our times or anything. It's just me telling a bunch of fun jokes, I think. And I just hope people enjoy it. I just really hope people watch it and go, hey, that was an hour of my day well spent.
Sounds amazing. But what is the big dream for you finally? Like, you have a Hasan Minhaj who has his own show with Netflix.
Right,
there's
right,
a big
right.
writer's room, people right. working under him. There's Lily Singh who has,
sure.
is on late night TV.
Sure.
What's the big dream for you?
The big dream for me is, like, this is ever since I was a kid, alright? I have been a geek and a nerd. I am a huge genre fan. I will watch any horror thing. I will watch any science fiction thing. I will watch any mystery, fantasy, whatever thing. And one of the things that's killed me about growing up in this country is just how undiversified our content was. I don't know about you, but I just feel like we grew up watching the same soap operas,
sure.
the same everything.
Sure.
My main dream actually in life is to make some kick-ass, fun genre fiction shows like the ones I grew up watching. To do something fun in like the sort of horror space or sci-fi space or mystery space. And that's actually my dream, to be a writer, director of fun fictional content. To be able to take all of this stuff and take these abilities from this medium and hopefully translate them into like bigger, funner canvases. That's something that I've always wanted to do. To make like a horror comedy or a sci-fi comedy. That is the dream for me. That is the ultimate dream.
Cannot wait.
Fingers crossed. Like the ideal is J.J. Abrams. Alright, I don't think that'll happen. I can already see the comments and this thing. Hey, go go J.J. That's not what I mean. That's not even slightly what I mean. But I'm just saying that I think I love the work those people have done in their careers at this sort of intersection of things that make people happy in the mainstream, but also have a very distinct voice.
Of course.
And that's the goal, always. To tell really fun stories for the rest of my life. That's the dream.
Nice. You're clearly on the right path and doing great work. Thank you
Thank
so
you.
Much
Thank
for
you
chatting
for
with me
Pau
and helping
Bhaji
me discover a whole other side of Bombay.
Absolutely. You're not getting the strawberry and cream back, by the way.
Neither are you.
Fair.
Thank
fair.
You.
Thanks. Hi guys, this has been Spill the Tea with Sneha. If you have enjoyed this, please remember to like, share and subscribe to Chocolate Milkshake. No, no, to Film Companion. To Film Companion. Like, share and subscribe to Film Companion. But
Thanks.
Also Chocolate Milkshake. But also Film Companion. But also Chocolate Milkshake. But mainly Film Companion.